Hello, I'm William Short of Hurstwic, and we're aboard the Cyrop, a replica longship operated by the Longship Company in Maryland. We've just finished some time trials, testing how Viking sailors may have rowed their ships. And in this video, we'll share our experiments and our results with you. We know quite a bit about the gear used for rowing a Viking ship. Archaeologists studying Viking ships have found hulls and oars well enough preserved to allow for detailed measurements. What is less well known is how this equipment was put to use. The saga literature says little. Based on ancient nautical terms, combined with estimates of Viking ship speeds while being rowed, some have speculated that the stroke speed was a relatively slow 10 to 12 strokes per minute, with two-hour shifts on the oars. In our experiments aboard the Cyrop, we tried three different approaches to rowing, based on speculation from experienced rowers. A short, fast stroke, perhaps influenced by the approach used by modern rowing teams. For a variety of reasons, it's the stroke used by the Longship Company as their standard general-purpose stroke. A long, slow stroke, influenced by linguistic studies and by body mechanics considerations brought with us from our combat training. A stylized stroke, with a pause in the recovery, used for formal events in later periods, but not known to have been used in the Viking Age. The stroke would have advantages when rowing in the direction of relatively fast currents. We outfitted the ship with a GPS unit that measured the ship's speed relative to bottom, and with a log, a calibrated flow meter that measured the ship's speed relative to water. This measurement tends to reduce the effect of water currents on our speed measurements. For some of the time trials, we also measured the acceleration of the ship using a three-axis accelerometer mounted on the deck above the keel in the bow. For each rowing style, we rowed the same closed straight-line course between two points, first in one direction, then back in the other. The intent was to reduce the effect of wind and currents on our measurements. The test course was set up in the ship's home waters of Maryland, just off of St. Clements Bay in Canoe Neck Creek. The course was set up in a sheltered area, hoping to avoid the stiff winds blowing on the weekend we made our measurements. Regardless, a portion of the course had a headwind in one direction and a tailwind in the other. We plotted the ship's speed relative to water versus the position of the ship. The results speak for themselves. The short, fast stroke averaged 2.7 knots relative to water on our closed course. The long, slow stroke averaged 3.2 knots, nearly 20% faster. The pause stroke averaged 2.2 knots, nearly 20% slower. More importantly, how did the strokes compare for the rowers? We asked them shortly after the conclusion of the time trials.
So with the longer strokes, I found myself getting tired less than with the short strokes. It's using a lot more of the long muscles along the back. And the short strokes were using like all the shoulders and upper arms, and it was tough to keep up, and it was just kind of frantic motion, and I felt like there was a lot of wasted energy.
I think with the long strokes, you would be able to maintain that for a lot longer than the short strokes, because like Matt said, the short strokes were very tiring. They were just really choppy and fast and seemed very tiring. As were the longer strokes, you were able to just pull your body through it and use the bigger muscles and were a lot less tired.
Our instrumentation revealed some other interesting things. For example, the headwind had a greater effect on the pause stroke than on the other two strokes. This is not surprising, since the unpowered recovery phase is longer, allowing the wind more time to slow down the ship. That realization made us wonder if the duty cycle of the three strokes had an impact on their effectiveness. Using video recorded of the rowing, we measured the average duty cycle of the three strokes, the percentage of the time the oars were in the water for each full stroke. We realized that power is not generated for every moment the oar is in the water, but we thought this measure might give us some sense of the relative percentage of time spent generating power for each of the three strokes. The short, fast stroke had a duty cycle of 42%. The long, slow stroke had a duty cycle of 52%, nearly 20% better. The pause stroke, surprisingly, had a duty cycle of 40%, not that much shorter than the short, fast stroke. Regardless, the greater duty cycle of the long, slow stroke probably goes a long way to explain why greater speed was achieved with that stroke. The accelerometer data also helps us to understand the power generation of the stroke. The plot shows ship acceleration, averaged over a number of strokes using the short, fast approach. The sharp increase in acceleration occurs during the bite of the oar, and the acceleration continues at a near steady level as the force is transferred from rowers and hull to oars and water. For the remainder of the stroke, as the oars are lifted and the recovery takes place, acceleration becomes deceleration as the drag of the water slows the ship. Acceleration data for the individual strokes tell us a lot about how well the rowers worked as a team. If the oars did not hit the water in unison, the leading edge of the acceleration peak clearly shows it. An oar touching the water in recovery is shown by a sudden deceleration. These experiments are hardly conclusive. They were simply meant to be a way to test the waters, to verify that our measurement apparatus would capture the data we needed for our tests. It was simply a test run. The data suggests many more experiments yet to be conducted, and we look forward to continuing our experiments in the next sailing season. The Longship Company welcomes the opportunity to collaborate on experiments of this type. Hurstwic thanks the Longship Company for their cooperation with us on these tests.